Well, it finally happened. After nearly a year since the initial release trailer for Horizon Forbidden West, we were treated to a PlayStation State of Play focused exclusively on the much-anticipated sequel to Zero Dawn. We will be diving into spoiler territory concerning everything we know about Forbidden West, as well as connections we can make to Zero Dawn. So, without further ado, let's dive into everything the showcase had to offer. Prior to any gameplay being shown, the countdown itself gave us some very interesting information concerning some of the locations we'll discover in the Forbidden West. Each location shown came with its own corresponding set of real-world coordinates, and some were even given additional context and information from Guerrilla Games' official Twitter account. The first location revealed to us is known as Barren Light, located in the real-world location of Shaver Lake, California, south of Yosemite National Park and the Sierra National Forest. Due to the architecture of this tower, along with its name, I'd say it's pretty safe to say that this is or was a Karja outpost. Though travel west beyond the Fortress of Sunfall is forbidden to the tribe, hence the name, this decree was due to the fact that the sixth Sun King of the tribe, Bold Reeve, took a cohort of men into the west chasing the Path of the Sun, and never returned. These landmarks of the familiar tribe may be the remnants of this expedition if they were able to survive beyond the reach of the Sundom. Next, we have the High Turning, built atop a ruin of the Old Ones southwest of Yosemite. More specifically, thanks to the provided coordinates, it appears this newer settlement is built atop of what was once the O'Shaughnessy Dam, used centuries before to impound the Tuolumne River, creating a reservoir for the surrounding populace. It now appears to have long since failed, with the river now reclaiming its natural course, and the new residents fortifying the ruin. For these next two locations, we see some of the more arid and unforgiving landscapes the American West has to offer. On the left, we see the Dry Urn and Scalding Spear on the right, located east and southeast of Modesto, California, respectively. We unfortunately didn't receive any supplementary information concerning these locales from Guerrilla, but some may recognize Scalding Spear as the area Aloy comes across after cresting a hill looking onto the desert in the reveal trailer, apparently some kind of solar farm left from the 21st century. However, to the best of my knowledge, none exist in the area at the present time. This wouldn't be the first time Horizon has placed a landmark in the world that is yet to be constructed, as we see that the 90-story skyscraper that sits at the heart of Devil's Grief in HCD is also yet to begin construction as of the making of this video. Located east of present-day Stockton, California, is the small village of Saltbite. As we hear from Guerrilla, the desert Tanakh village of Saltbite rests at the shores of an acrid lake that shares its name. Birds that nest in the brackish outskirts provide much-needed food supplies for the clan's larger settlements, Arrowhand and Scalding Spear. Though the coordinates don't match exactly, the closest present-day body of water the settlement could reside on would be Turlock Lake to the northeast. But being that the game takes place nearly 1,000 years after the events of the Pharaoh Plague, the lake may very well just not exist in the 21st century. Accounts of the Forbidden West from scanned glyphs describes mysterious individuals on the waters of a great lake riding thin, dark boats. Perhaps the natives of Saltbite will be those described, or maybe match those residing in more coastal settlements. Additionally, we are given a name of another settlement, Arrowhand. This settlement wasn't revealed to us in the countdown, so whether we'll be able to visit this place or not is unknown to us at present, and may only end up residing in the lore, akin to such places as Ben-Ur and Mainspring. Next are the snowy Shearside Mountains. Though this settlement appears to be built high on the cliffs of this rock formation, its coordinates indicate it sits in modern-day Tracy, California, appearing to be quite flat from some initial prying. Regardless, in the 31st century, the area has become quite jagged, along with the mentality of those who reside there. The Sky Clan of the Tanakhth live among the Shearside Mountains, guarding their territory from intruders. Their defenses are said to be impregnable against man and machine, and no force can march upon their settlements without being observed from above. It will be interesting to see how Aloy is able to navigate this formidable settlement if she's not welcome from the onset. Lush and vibrant, the Rain Tray sits in modern-day Patterson, west of San Jose. The lowland clan of the Tanakhth make its home in the swamps and jungles of the Rain Trace. They excel at tricks and traps, blending into the jungle unseen, then relying on machines lurking in the marshes to thin out their foes. Judging by its appearance and description, this area may be the location where Aloy stumbled upon the Shell Snapper in the initial Forbidden West trailer. It seems, however, that the machines may be the least of your worries when traversing this beautiful but dangerous land. Built in the shadow of an ancient horse-class titan is the Valley of the Fallen. With a perilous reputation, this valley will either prove a warrior's grit or often claim their life. This dangerous cove holds great significance for the Lowland Tanakhth clan. If a soldier can last 10 days and 10 nights against the machines that dwell here, the deed will be marked in ink upon their skin, an honor few survive to receive. If you spot someone with these markings, they may be harder to handle than your average hunter, but who knows, maybe we'll be seeing Aloy get some more permanent ink instead of just the face paints from HCD. The last location revealed was the beautiful coastal village of Tides Reach, sitting on the eastern beaches of the San Francisco Bay. The settlement of Tides Reach grants the Lowland Tanakhth a view of the long coast, ensuring no raiders tread upon its sands unseen. Across the water is the ancient Isle of Spires, but the roiling currents of the bay prevent safe passage to its shores. Accounts from Karja historians could not even begin to comprehend the concept of something like the Pacific Ocean, describing it as best they could as a lake 100 times larger than the Daybreak, and waters that would rise up and push back against those who would attempt to cross. As with those societies that we have come to know in HCD, I cannot wait to see how these people's beliefs and mythologies were shaped being next to the sea, surrounded by the remnants of some of the most fierce fighting the world has ever known. Which brings us to the showcase itself, one that highlights a number of different mechanics, machines, and enemy combatants. I highly recommend you take the time to watch the presentation if you haven't already, link in the description, you won't regret it. To summarize, the featured scenario finds Aloy searching for Erend, her friend and ally who she had tasked with recovering a piece of ancient technology hidden somewhere in the Isle of Spires, or what is present-day San Francisco. Unfortunately, she finds his group of Osram have been ambushed, with her friend being taken captive by raiders from a rebel faction of Tanakhth. Interestingly, these warriors were able to override machines to their will, and in this particular instance, the machines being Claw Striders. After Aloy is pursued by the machines, she is able to make her escape using a variety of new tactics, diving beneath the water, and reaching a different shore for safety. From there, she manages to override her own Claw Strider, and confronts Erend's captors. Before she is able to free Erend, a massive tremor tusk controlled by the faction attacks, and a truly epic battle ensues. Using new and old tactics alike, she is able to bring the machine down and save her friend. Luckily, though captured, Erend was able to complete his mission, and gives the uncovered device to Aloy. She then uses her focus to activate the data within, showing a map of the 31st century Earth, along with the catastrophic readings of the storm that is close at hand. Though we may have only gotten a small glimpse of what lies in store for us, let's take a closer look at what was shown to us in the reveal. When Aloy comes across the defeated Osram, we see her fitted with brand new armor. Judging by its appearance of woven leaves and grasses, it would appear that this is of Utaru design, a more peaceful clan known to reside in the Forbidden West, indicating that by this point in the story, she may have encountered the tribe in some way or another. Though more ornamented or perhaps modified than before, it seems she is still armed with the spear she was given by Silence towards the end of the first game. This weapon has already been used to further his plans in the past, so the fact that she still has it could have some very interesting ramifications. She then makes her way into the ruins of San Francisco, where we see sunwings in the sky, and on land, the vicious pack hunters known as Claw Striders. As we said before, we see that this group is controlled by a Tanakhth rebel, having been overridden to his control. Aloy is understandably very surprised by this fact, being that the knowledge of how to override machines in the world of Horizon up to this point has been extremely limited, principally to Aloy and Silence. Connecting the dots from this showcase and the initial release trailer, I think it's a safe bet to say that we will find Silence at the heart of this new faction, granting his knowledge to these raiders. But of course, the harder question to answer at this point is why? Nothing Silence does is without motive. Much like his role in the founding of the Cult of the Eclipse in the first game, in Silence's desire to achieve his ambitions, he has shown little to no regard for anyone beyond himself. We may see Aloy and Silence at odds with each other more than ever before in this game over the mysteries of the ancient world. In this encounter, using a smoke bomb, Aloy is able to temporarily blind the predators to begin her escape. As Aloy flees, we are shown how climbing an additional traversal will be different than before. Rather than simply looking for painted yellow ledges and handholds, your focus scan will let you know what areas are able to be climbed. Furthermore, we see a new tool, the Pull Caster, in action, allowing Aloy to attach and cling to vertical surfaces for faster movement or quick escapes. After diving away from the dangerous Claw Striders, we get a glimpse into the underwater world of the Sunken City. Using her dive mask, we are told that we will be able to stay under as long as we wish, being able to really explore the sunken remnants of the metal world. Breathtaking for sure, but the most notable moment from this section of the playthrough was our first look at a brand new kind of machine known as burrowers. We only get a short glimpse as Aloy makes her way past, but due to their design, it would appear that these machines will be amphibious, and it'll be very interesting to see what their behavior will be on land and what role they may play in the overall terraforming system. Another interesting piece that seems to set the sequel apart from HCD is the prevalence of fallen Pharaoh machines that are littered throughout the landscapes. Lore-wise, seeing more of these and other military relics from the human side of Enduring Victory makes sense, as some of the most fearsome battles of the plague were fought on the coasts of the continental United States, such as the battles of the California Marine and the Eastern Seaboard Wall. By the time the plague reached the areas we were able to explore in the first game, humanity's forces were much, much weaker, and were less and less effective in bringing the Pharaoh bots down. Once Aloy tracks down Erend, we get our first look into melee combat. According to game director Matthias Theon, we will be using different combos to achieve various new effects, charge attacks, and something called a Valor Surge to utilize special abilities in the heat of combat. After this, we see yet another new tool in action, the Shield Wing, giving us a new glide mechanic and the ability to leap from great heights with relative safety. She then goes on to override her own Claw Strider, just the first in what is promised to be an expanded mount list from the first game, and finally makes it to Erend. This is where the Tremor Tusk appears. After her Claw Strider is blasted out from under her, we see three new kinds of weaponry in action. First is the Oseram Forge Blast Spike Thrower, an explosive javelin that seems to pack a punch on both robotic and human combatants alike, even blasting one Tenacth completely out of their armor. Next is the Karja Adhesive Blast Sling, able to throw sticky grenades to slow movement of enemy machines. And finally, the Tanakh the Ranger Sharpshot Bow. Various bows are nothing new to Horizon, but the ammunition and ability, heavy arrows and the emplaced shot, are quite different, seemingly combining the best parts of the charging feature of Banuk bows and the component removing capabilities of Tear Blast arrows. It seems we have yet another tool to tear armor and target machine components and weaponry. According to the gameplay deep dive at the end of the stream, we learn that we will be able to upgrade our weapons using a workbench mechanic opposed to simply buying better variants like before. Color has always determined an item's rarity, green being common onto purple indicating rare, so maybe these arrowhead icons will be the indicator for the number of times the weapon can be upgraded along with its current level, with the symbols to the right indicating the all-too-familiar weapon coils we have come to know and love. Once the Tremor Tusk is brought down and Erend is freed, we are able to see for the very first time what the world of the 31st century looks like on a global scale, and things have certainly changed. On the East Coast, we see the Florida Peninsula along with sections of what was once Georgia, Alabama, South, and North Carolina being submerged beneath the ocean. Cuba also seems to have been wiped off the map, along with a number of other Caribbean islands suffering the same fate, or have had their land masses greatly diminished. The West Coast has also seen some change in overall topography, with what was once the Baja California Peninsula being lost in its present-day location, now appearing way farther north close to San Francisco due to changing sea levels. Judging by the map at present, coastal cities farther south like Los Angeles may be lost entirely. Slightly after the map reveal, we were able to see that Erend is now equipped with a focus, perhaps taken from a fallen member of the Eclipse after the Battle of the Alight. Regardless, if all of Aloy's allies have gained access to this ancient tech, I wouldn't be surprised if long-range communication with them plays a large role as a storytelling device throughout the game. Finally, we come to the map itself, Lucky for me, my wonderful wife Silver has a degree in meteorology and was able to decipher, far better than I ever could, what exactly we're looking at here. Let's start by examining the large weather system we see in the Pacific. The colored lines running across the map indicate wind direction and speed. This is important because we see the direction moving inwards, counterclockwise, and intensifying in speed as it draws closer to its center. Occurring in the northern hemisphere, all this indicates an immensely strong, low-pressure system. All this is extremely important to contextualize the true scale of what we are about to witness happen over the ruins of San Francisco. This number is a measure of atmospheric pressure, shown in hectopascals. The standard atmospheric pressure at sea level is 1013 HPA. We see in the hologram that the atmospheric pressure of the 31st century is even higher. When the device zooms in, however, we see the pressure drop and hover close to 910 HPA, conditions similar to what we would expect to see in strong hurricanes or typhoons. But the truly terrifying fact is that this drop in pressure is occurring over a matter of seconds. In our world today, this level of explosive cyclogenesis is unheard of. Essentially, what we're seeing here are weather systems potentially larger and more destructive than Hurricane Katrina, but forming in a matter of seconds. If these other markings are predicting similar weather patterns or ones already in motion, then the imminent destruction the world is facing is catastrophic, to say the least. If this problem remains unchecked or worsens, the tribal societies of the world most likely will not be able or equipped to withstand it. These maritime storms paired with the continental supercell storms we saw in the first trailer are, according to the devs, somehow related to the technology of the Rebel faction. All this talk of weather and climate to most lore folks screams of the AI Vast Silver. If you are unaware of this AI's background, I highly recommend you check out our video concerning AIs in Horizon, but with its penchant for climate intervention, it's hard to imagine it's not going to be involved in whatever is occurring across the world, for better or for worse. With Silence seemingly pulling the strings of this new faction, and Hades potentially still under his lock and key, there is no telling what he could accomplish if we were able to get his hands on an AI with a similar sentience level as Gaia. But once again, what's his endgame? For a man who has always sought knowledge over power, whatever he's after, it must be of the utmost importance. In summary, we've learned quite a bit from this much-anticipated reveal. We were exposed to new locations, mechanics, weapons, machines, and plot points that we didn't have before, yet so much remains unanswered. The red blight rages on, while the falling stars seem to point to a long-forgotten mission to planets beyond our solar system. But perhaps the most important question that remains is, when will this amazing game be released? Though we don't have the answer at this time, Guerrilla Games did tweet that a development is on track and that they will have an update for us very soon. So until then, we here at RSQ and the Horizon Lore community will keep our eyes peeled for all the knowledge we can muster as we eagerly await more information on Horizon Forbidden West. And that brings our journey to an end. If you'd like to see more content like this, likes and shares are always appreciated. If you're hungry for more lore on Horizon Forbidden West and Zero Dawn, be sure to subscribe and check out all of our lore content here at the channel. Also, consider supporting the channel on Patreon to help us make more quality content just like this. Check out the link in the description. And as always, thanks for watching, and keep questin'.